Hi everybody, how are you doing this afternoon? My name is Bruce Johnson and I am going to be talking to you today, this afternoon, or this morning, depending upon where you are, I guess, about developing apps for Office. I'm actually the Vice President of Technology at Object Sharp Consulting. What that basically means is that of the people who are helping to run Object Sharp, I'm the one that is probably the geekiest. It's the status that I hold particularly well. As I said, we're going to be talking about developing apps for Office. This is actually a new app model. If you've been developing applications for Office up to this particular point, there's a lot of stuff that happens to have changed with 2013 in terms of the capabilities that you have, in terms of what it's possible that you could be doing, in terms of just how you generally approach developing applications. I've been talking about the topic since, I want to say probably the end of last year, done it many, many times. It's actually very, very cool and very, very slick. So what we're going to be doing is talking about a couple of things. First of all, introduce you basically to what the Apps for Office happens to be. We'll talk about we'll talk about exactly what it means for developing document-centric applications. We'll talk a little bit about mailbox-centric applications. It's just as possible to create applications for Outlook as it is possible to create applications for Word, Excel, PowerPoint. There's a lot of similarity in the two models. There's also some differences, and we'll be kind of talking about the way those both happen to go. But my starting point is going to basically be, what is this thing called an app for Office? Now the idea is that, and actually probably the best way to start off more than anything else is actually to show you what the app for Office happens to look like. And so to do that, let me pull up a Word document as my starting point. And so standard Word document, nothing particularly special about what you're seeing here. On my insert tab, and this is, by the way, this is Word 2013, just so you're aware. On my insert tab, what you end up with is an app for Office bar. And this app for Office, you have the ability to go in and grab apps for Office that happen to be out there. And so, for example, I can go in and I can pick this Bing image search and I can insert that application into this particular document. And so what it's actually going off and doing right now is off here on the left-hand side, what you end up seeing is the what ultimately is a web page, and that's kind of the key to all of this. This is a Bing image search, so what we're going to do is we're going to search things up in here, and I click on search, and it loads up things nicely, and then I can select things, and I can go and I can add them into my document, and in a few moments, assuming I've clicked that properly, you will theoretically, he says, there we go. That's what I was looking for. It's just a matter of timing. So basically what I've got is a website off here on the right-hand side in what's called a task pane application that is capable of interacting with the document that you happen to have opened up. So at a in nutshell, in basically a nothing more than a couple of words, that's basically what this app for Office is. It's the ability to have a website that is running inside of the context of Word or Excel or PowerPoint or Outlook that has also the capability to interact with the document itself using JavaScript. Okay, and that's the kind of the beginnings of this. So what is an app for Office? It's a web page that loads up inside of an Office application. It's a web page that it's embedded inline. We'll show you what that looks like in just a couple of seconds. It's embedded as a task pane application, which is the one you just happened to see. It works in both rich client Office. It also works in Office Web. Same application in both cases. The thing that's actually quite cool about this more than anything else is the technologies that you can bring to bear on solving the problem of writing applications for Office. It's a website that you've created, which means that you can host the website on IIS using ASP.NET, MVC. The rendering that you see inside of Word is done through HTML5, CSS, JavaScript. Pure, that's straight up nothing but that. You can use jQuery if you want to. You can use Knockout. You can use Backbone, Mongo, pick your favorite web technologies and they can be rendered inside of that particular pane. the information, the interactions that you have going back and forth between the your app, your website, and the document itself is done through a REST-based API, done through client-side JavaScript calls that we'll actually take a look at a little bit later on. But ultimately, what you've done is rather than having to write a custom piece of code, write a C# or a VB application, or do scripting to be able to interact with the page, you actually can do this as a separate standalone thing. One of the other benefits that you get is that the install process is not really an install process. You saw me install the Bing search into my application. The install, and I hesitate to use the word, but just so we understand the concept, was a piece of XML that got associated with that particular document. And the XML points to the place where the web page happens to be. And it handles or describes some of the capabilities and some of the permissions, but it's a really, really, really tiny little document that happens to be out there. Now, a couple of different applications that you can have, apps for Office that you can have. I've already shown you the task pane app that happened to be out there. There's also a content app that I'll show you in just a quick second, and also a mail app that, again, I'll show you a little bit later on. So you've got access to each one of those. Now, the inline app that you can see, if I actually come up in here, we're going to load that up. And we've got bubbles. This is literally my most favorite demo application for when I happen to be working inside of, when I'm working with the Ops for Office. And that should load up in just a couple of seconds. This is what, as you'll notice, by the way, this is a website. It is a website that happens to be working someplace else. Now, what you will see is that I've got here, this is what the inline app happens to look like. And you know something? It looks like, you know, we're going to have to just simply bail on that, which is too bad. Bubbles is my fun one. We'll come back to what one of those looks like a little bit later on. So let's come back into here for just a second. Okay. So probably the key thing that you happen to have here is that the applications themselves are websites, standalone sites. There's interactions that happen. The fact that you saw me taking a little bit of time to load up might be an indication that they're actual websites hosted someplace else. They can be hosted wherever you want to, and they can run any technology that you happen to want to. When you're talking about an app for Office, basically what makes up an app for Office is two things, actually. First of all, you'll notice that at the bottom I've got an app for Office manifest. This is the XML that I was talking about a few minutes ago. Points to a web page, defines the type of app for Office that it happens to be, whether it supports Word, whether it supports Excel, whether it supports Outlook, what kind of permissions it happens to require. And the second piece is the web page itself. And the web page itself is just a web page, HTML, JavaScript, jQuery, CSS, standard functionality, again, hosted using any technology you want. So the big gain here is that if you're trying to visualize information that happens to be sitting on the client side, then, if you're trying to visualize the information that happens to be inside of your document, you're using techniques that are incredibly well known. You can use the kind of UI components that you're used to draw graphs and charts and to do things like that with respect to how your application happens to work out. Now, the nice thing is, from a development perspective, that it's all built into Visual Studio 2012. Now, in order to be able to get this, in order to have these templates show up, because these are standard templates, you actually have to download the Office Developer Tools. So that's the SDK that you actually have to download. But once you download it, it adds a couple of project templates in there for Office, one for Office and one for SharePoint 2013. When you go through the process of creating an application, you will end up seeing the choice of applications you want to work with. And when it actually builds up, it creates two projects. And let me give you an example of what that looks like. So if I take a look here, what you'll see is I actually have two projects in my application. So I have got this concept of a translator, this app web. This app web is my actual functionality, my actual website. And you can see in here, I've got an HTML page, and we'll drill down into exactly what is in here in a couple of minutes. But basically, you know, I have that HTML. And then I've also what I've been calling my install or my deployment project, which consists of the XML that I mentioned before. And if I actually open this up, right, I have a nice little designer view. But if I drill into my XML a little bit, this is the little piece of XML that ends up being deployed. And so as you go and put that out onto when you install it, basically, this is the thing that actually gets installed. I don't have an executable, and I have an MSI. I don't have to go through all of those gyrations to get things installed. This sits inside of my account and actually tells where to go. And what you can actually see right here is the source location where it's going to find my page ultimately. So that's how the applications happen to sit out from a development perspective. Now, if you're actually trying to work with this, there are a couple of objects, very standard objects that you happen to work with. First of all, there is office.context. I should probably say, as we're kind of going through this, one of the things that you do need to have if you're going to be working with apps for Office is you need to include this office.js file. It includes all of the JavaScript objects that you need to be able to manipulate the document themselves. And so there is an office.context object, which is kind of the entry point into all of the things that you happen to be working with. There is an office.context.document, and through the office.context.document object, you're going to be able to read and write selections. You'll be able to create bindings so that listen to events. If a selection changes, then you'll be able to be notified of it. If a value inside of a range changes, your website will get notified as well. And that's how the communication happens to exist between the document itself and your application. It's done by these events. Okay. Also included in office.context, there's something called roaming settings. And what roaming settings lets you do is it allows you to read and write properties to the document. And one of the interesting things about the way the Apps for Office model works is when you take a document and you inject the app into it, the information about that app is now included in that document. So if I was to send that document to somebody else, the app would travel along with it. When you use things like the roaming settings, what you're doing is you're reading and writing properties into the document's metadata that would then be picked up by somebody else who happens to open the app from within that particular document. So it allows you to persist information with the document itself. There's also an office.context.mailbox, and we'll talk about that when we talk about some of the mailbox-centric applications that are out there. So all of your data access goes through that document object. Turns out there's basically three types of data that are supported in terms of being able to manipulate it. There's text data, which is more or less a string. And then there is a matrix and a table. And both a matrix and a table are two-dimensional arrays. The difference between the two is that the matrix happens to be a fixed size. So if you set the matrix up to be, think of Excel, set it up to be, you know, four columns and five rows, then it's always going to look in that four columns and five rows. On the other hand, if you create a table, then you'll find that as you make changes to the table, increase the number of rows, that information then is able to be retrieved by the process. And basically what you're looking at in terms of the coding, it's actually dirt simple. And this is one of the things that, as I've talked to people about this, they have seen it happen. It's just one of the things that I find most fascinating about it. The technology, the steps you have to go through to get the data from the Office document and to push the data back into the Office document are dirt simple. You will spend much, much more time coming up with ways to visualize and work with the data than you will actually getting the data itself. So what you're actually seeing here on the screen is a couple of different things. We're seeing the office initialize function. Basically, this is kind of your entry point in. So office.initializes gets called when the office.js is finished loading, the document is ready to be processed. And typically, you're going to use this particular method to kind of work on stuff that is initialization, event handlers. And that's exactly what's happening here. You can see that I'm doing this office.context.document.addHandlerAsync. And the name of my handler is, the name of my event is document selection changed. And so what that's basically doing is that is saying if something on the selection of the document changes, I want you to call my update method. The update method is down in here. And what the update method is doing is it's calling getSelectedDataAsync. And that getSelectedDataAsync is going to go and grab the data from the document. You can see that it's type text. And when it finishes getting it, this is an asynchronous call, so you've got to use a callback. When you actually get the callback, then it's going to grab the value out of the result that you happen to see, and it is going to set the source. And if you check set source at the bottom, what set source is basically doing in this particular example is it's going off to Wikipedia, building up a list, and it's actually displaying the information that happens to be there in the right hand side. And that's what you would actually get on the right hand side if you actually followed this these particular steps. So basically what you've got is, as a starting point, to be able to get selected data, that's fine. If you want to be able to set selected data, there is also a set selected data async method. And that set selected data async method allows you to pass in the data type, the data itself, a string or an object of some kind. And it's an asynchronous call, so once it's been successfully inserted into the document, your callback ends up getting fired back on the other side. So in terms of passing data, there's basically three different types of shapes you can use. There is a text shape, which will pass the data as a string. There's a matrix shape, which again is two-dimensional JavaScript array, and there's also a table shape, which you actually have to pass in using a table data object. And the table data object is the thing that allows, again, it's the representation of the dynamically sized table that happens to exist inside of the document itself. It's also possible, if you're really so inclined, you can pass in HTML strings, you can pass in OpenOffice XML format. So you've got the ability to inject a lot of stuff into the document itself. The only potential issue, the only caveat you have here is that if you're dealing with a table size, it's very, very similar to if you're trying to do a paste into an Excel spreadsheet. If you happen to have selected a 2x2 range of cells and you select a 3x3 range and try to do a paste, you get an error message. Well, the same thing happens here. If you try and do that kind of pasting into an area that's not selected property, your callback will end up with an error coming out of it that you have to be able to handle from that particular perspective. But within within that caveat, pretty much everything else you have is what you would expect it to be. So let me start by going to a demo of the reading and the writing so you can actually see what the code looks like. And so to do that, I'm going to drop out of this, and I'm going to actually get into what my the app is. So as a starting point, allow me to run the application. You can actually see what it happens to look like. I launch the application. I start up Word. It quite nicely. There's my little task pane application. And the basic functionality in the task pane application is the following. If I select a row here on my document itself, I can click on the read button. You can see that it says hello world. I've got the ability to translate that into Spanish, hola mundo, and then I can write it back out to my document. Okay. The other thing I can do is I can specify an event being raised. So if I click on the event, double click on beer, you'll notice that beer in my translator app was picked up. Again, I can do a quick translate on that. You'll notice it's cerveza. And again, I can just simply take that. I can write that back into wherever I happen to want to go. Oops, put that back again. Do my little translate, do my little write. And again, popped it right back into the document. So that's the functionality that this particular application happens to be demonstrating. And let's take a look at what actually is going on under the covers. First of all, you'll notice that on the HTML page itself, it's massively simplistic. So first of all, I've got some jQuery. I've got the Microsoft Ajax.js file that happens to be there. I've got the Office.js that I mentioned before that actually has all of the objects that I need to work with. And then I've got my translator app.js, which is where I happen to have put in most of my functionality. The user interface is incredibly sophisticated design. You'll notice it consists of four buttons, each of which has IDs that are more or less matching on to what you would have expected the read, write, translate, and event buttons to be earlier on. And I've also got an empty div called display. So this isn't where the work actually happens. The joyous part actually happens inside of my translator app script. And so to take a look at what that happens to look like, okay, so first of all, I have my Office initialize that's out there. My Office initialize stores an instance of my context.document, mostly just because I'm lazy and I don't want to keep typing stuff. And then it creates handlers for my click events. So that you can see I've got, here's my read selection that happens to be there, and I've got an on read selection that I'm able to work with. I've got my register event handler, so when I want to register my event, again, it's going to call that method, translate, write selection, and so on. So let's actually walk through what the process was and take a look at the code that happens to be executed, and you'll see how that flows. So the first thing we did was we selected something from the document and we clicked on the read. Clicking on read is going to cause my on read selection to get triggered. And what my on read selection does is it calls get selected data async. It's of type text, which means it's a string. And when it's finished retrieving the information, it's going to call on read selection complete, which grabs the value of the async result property, that is the actual string that was selected, and it pops it into my display div. So the code that you see here is all that's necessary to, well, between the get selected data and these two lines of code, grab the information off the document, pop it into my website. The next thing we did was called translate, and as I mentioned, this is the I would say the most sophisticated part of it, the onTranslate. We call the onTranslate method. And what onTranslate is doing is it is going, grabbing the information that happens to be in my display div, building up this URL. It's saying it's going from English to Spanish. When it's finished, I want to call this particular method. And here's the text that's being translated. It creates a script where the source of a script tag, script block, where the source of the script is this URL, and then appends it to the head. And so what that ultimately results in it doing is making the call off to the Bing translator. We get back the translated value. On translate complete ends up being called, and on translate complete down here takes the translated text, and we check to see if there is a value, and if there is, we dump it into my display div. Fairly straightforward. As I said, that visualization, that functionality, is the most complicated thing you're going to have to be working with here. The next thing was we did a write. On the write selection, we call on write selection. And what write selection does is it calls set selected data async, and that's going to push the value from my display div, tagging on a carriage return line feed onto it, and it pushes that information back out to the document. Okay, very simple, very straightforward. Now the fourth thing we did is we clicked on the event button, and when we click on the event button, we register this event handler, and the register event handler says, hey, go into add handler async. If the document selection changes, I want you to call on selection change JavaScript method. The onSelectionChange JavaScript method itself calls getSelectedData with a type of text. When I'm finished, call onReadSelectionComplete, which takes the value of my selection and puts it into my display div. And so basically at that point now, every time I do a selection off of my document, you're going to find the word ends up appearing inside of my website. And so like I said, very, very simple, very, very straightforward kinds of functionality to be able to get back to the point where we're dealing with those particular documents. Now, there are app bindings that happen to be out there, and what the The idea behind an app binding is more or less the following. So far, we've been working with selected data, but it might very well be that you want to get to the point where you are not simply working with the data that you select. You may have ranges that you've been previously defined. You don't want to depend upon your user to do a selection before something takes place. And what the app bindings allow you to do is they allow you to indicate your interest in a named region or a specified region inside of the document with which you happen to be working with. And once you have indicated that interest, you have the ability to read and write to that area in exactly the same way that, not exactly the same way, it's not the same method, but it's basically the same process. You can get information out of a named region, you can set information in a named region so that you can manipulate the information to areas that the user not necessarily has selected. You can have event handling on it. You'll notice at the bottom of the slides, there's actually three different data shapes that happen to be available to you. There's a text binding, there's a matrix binding, and there's a table binding. And they have the same basic functionality that text matrix and table binding, coercion types had when you were getting and setting the selected data. Text binding is aiming at, generally speaking, an individual cell in Excel or a string inside of Word. Matrix and table bindings are both two-dimensional arrays. Matrix is static in size once you've defined it, whereas table actually has the ability to change depending upon the data that you happen to have. And so you end up with the capability to have this kind of functionality that you see here. I've got, on a page, I've got this bound range of stock symbols. The stock symbols themselves would be normally stored inside of a data table, but as you select an element in there, there's a selection changed event that actually fires against the that my website would pick up, and in this case it's going to go and it's going to display the news for the selected stock symbol that happens to be out there. And that event handling is set up against the binding itself, so that, you know, I was go click on the MSFT or the IBM cell, you would find that the news on the website would end up changing in sync with that. Now, the process of actually using bindings is fairly straightforward. In terms of the mechanism that you happen to have, there's really three different ways to be able to access or to be able to add named bindings. So first of all, there's this concept of adding from a prompt, and there's the methods add from prompt async. And so what you do with the add from prompt is you, and you can see the code for it up here at the top, you can see that what's going on is I am grabbing the office context, I am creating a JavaScript object of the binding create options, I've got an ID, I've got a prompt text, I've got a callback. I'm passing that information into the add from prompt async method. And what that's going to do is, first of all, it's going to give the ID of my binding. It's going to have an ID of stock symbols. It's going to have some prompt text that says, please select a list of stock symbols. And when the selection is complete, it's going to call the onDataBound method. And if you take a look at the bottom portion of the right side, the lower right of the slide, you'll see that there is a prompt that gets done. And so when you call add from prompt, you pass the information, then the user gets prompted to select the items that happen to be inside of that particular range. And so they're using the standard selecting mechanism that Excel would offer, for example. And that, once they have made the selection, they click on OK, and the connection is now made. The prompt text that you specified in the JSON object is the prompt text that you see at the top of that particular dialog box. And once the selection has been made, then the onDataBound would be done, and you'll notice the very bottom line of the piece of code that happens to be up here is saying, I want to go to my office object, I want to get binding stock symbols. Stock symbols is the ID for my binding. I want to add a handler to that where my binding selection changed, and when the binding selection changed, I want you to call on selection changed. And so at that point, you know, on selection changed, you can go grab the value of the items that are selected, and then you can operate on them as you would, similar to what you saw before. Besides being able to access them through a prompt. You can access, you can say add from selection, which takes the current selection and allows you to be able to set up a binding between the two. As well, and this is probably the most powerful of them, you have the ability to add from a named item. Those of you who are familiar with Excel would be aware that Excel has got named items that happen to be out there. And so that you can specify that name and use that information to be able to say, I want to grab that range. Now, the reason why this is powerful is because it's quite possible to use a notation like sheet 1 exclamation mark B3 colon B5 as your named range. And by doing that, you now have the ability to be able to specify any range on the spreadsheet that you want to have access to. You've got the ability to manipulate the bindings. You can get all of them. You can get them by ID. You've seen the office.select that actually allows you to give it the name and be able to have access to the item, be able to add handler information to it, to be able to get the data from it. So you've got all of that functionality. Now, my little demo for this is going to be, let's get rid of you for a second, and I'm going to create a new, in particular, we're going to open up this particular template. So what you see here is a template, that an Excel template that happens to be out here. Okay, and so this is a standard template, but the idea here is that you've got the ability over here on the left-hand side there we go, that's what we're looking for. The Bing Finance that you see on the left-hand side of the document is the app itself. And as you, you know, change what you're selecting on the right-hand side, you'll notice that the news and the graph related to the left-hand side changes. So, you know, very nice. And this is, again, all, here's your, you know, the standard headlines, all of the functionality related to that. So I have the binding set up against my symbols, the symbols column, and that will automatically flesh out the information you see over here. And I've also got the ability, if I want to be able to add securities in. So if I go to the bottom of my screen here, you'll notice that right now the bottom is happens to be Nokia. But if I come in here and I say add General Motors, okay, and I select that, you'll notice that I can now say add to table, and it is going off and actually adding that General Motors information. And it should, if I actually live well, in a couple of seconds it's going to add it. There we go, you can see it just added the information down here to the bottom. Okay, so I have that ability to interact with the document that you happen to see here. I've even got the ability to add things like columns. So right now you'll notice that the extreme right of my spreadsheet is open. I can very easily add, let's see, we'll go with current price. That's already there. My bad, we'll go with day high. So if I add it in, drop it in there, in a couple of seconds you'll see day high happen to be added to my table that happened, that's displayed out there. And so by doing this, I now have this binding interaction that exists between the web application, my Bing Finance web application, and my data sheet itself. So I've got, again, really, really nice, and as I say, the interactions themselves here are not complicated. The complication is, you know, how long does it take to be able to go grab a graph, draw it, you know, handle all of the formatting of all of the information that you see here? That's really where the challenge happens to be, is in that particular side of it. And honestly, that's where you want it to be. You don't want to be spending a lot of time trying to figure out how to do that kind of functionality. Now, to this point, we've been talking about Word and Excel apps. We also mentioned earlier on that it's possible to have apps for Office running against mail-centric applications. And this is, again, very conceptually very similar. The differences tend to be in the some of the details, but ultimately this is still a website that happens to run. It's running outside of the application itself, so there's a control that's hosting the application inside of it, and that, by the way, is the technology. It's being hosted up inside of an iframe, either inside of a browser controller or inside of an iframe, depending upon whether you're doing Outlook web apps or whether you're doing the Outlook rich client, the Office web apps, the Office rich client stuff. The biggest difference here with the mail apps is that determination of whether a particular application appears is actually done through activation rules. Okay, and the activation rules are such that when you select a particular item inside of your mailbox, it takes a look at the some information about the item that you've selected, and based on that, and based on a set of rules that are defined by the application, it compares the two, and if it turns out that you know what you were looking for in the application matches what the item has to offer, then your application ends up being visible. And it ends up being visible in a menu bar that appears at the top of the application itself. Okay, and so to get a sense to see what that looks like, you'll notice that, and that's pretty much exactly what I've got here. I have got this idea of an app name. Okay, so in this particular instance, I've got Bing Maps, UPS tracking, Dynamics, YouTube, Bug Tracker. All of those things are activated within this particular message. The map that you see here, that's my mail app body. That's my web page, and then I've got content triggers down here below my app is the actual message itself, and there's things inside of the message that cause, or there can be things inside of the message that cause my app to be visible, and you can arrange or you can define that those things get highlighted so the user can actually see one of the reasons why your app might have possibly have been triggered. But that's the basic structure that you happen to look at. Now behind the scenes, what's actually happening is that your manifest, you still have the same XML file, that gets deployed to Exchange. One of your criteria for being able to use the apps for Outlook is you have to be running against Exchange 2013. The manifest, the XML file, ends up being saved into your user mailbox. The rules processing is done inside of the Outlook client. So the determination of whether a particular application should or shouldn't be there, that ends up being an Outlook thing more than anything else. And then your application itself uses the Office.js library to be able to interact back and forth with the your app and the mail item that you happen to work with, or the appointment, because that's the other possibility. Same kind of project template available for mail apps as there was for the other Office apps that are out there. Same two projects that happen to be available for visualization. But like I said, the difference here is that you end up with rule-based activation. So your mail apps are activated based on a set of rules. Now the rules themselves, and probably the easiest way to do this again is to show it. So let me pop up into here and open up a mail application. Now the rules themselves end up being stored inside of the application manifest, which is that XML file that gets delivered, and you can see that the information is right here. So here are my rules for this particular application. And there's a couple of things you'll notice right off the bat. First of all, I can have more than one rules, and I can use Boolean logic to handle them. So here is an AND rule, and what that basically says is this inner rule and this inner rule both have to evaluate to true in order for the application to be considered active. And then inside of that, I've got an OR rule. So this one has to be true or this one has to be true for my application to be active. So in this case, what it's saying is my item, the item I'm looking at, has to be either a message or an appointment, and it has to have this thing called item has a known entity. Now, one of the cool things, and I'm going to bump back into here for a second. Okay, so you've got a couple of different rules that are available to you. So I've got the item is, which you saw with the messenger appointment. I've got item has known entity. And the item has known entity allows me to use knowledge that Exchange has about the message to be able to help me with my rules. I don't have to write rules to determine whether or not a particular string is an address. Exchange will do that for me. So it actually looks at the messages, parses out some of this metadata, and uses that information to determine whether or not a particular mail item has got an address. And there's a number of different known entities. I'll show you on the next slide what they happen to be. I've also got the ability to do regular expression matching. So I can specify a regular expression that will be matched against the contents of a particular item, and if the match is true, then my application becomes valid. So those are very, very powerful options that happen to be available to you. And as you've seen, I've got the ability to have different rules, like my application rule, can be composed logically of multiple rules. Now, the well-known entities that I was talking about, and here's a list of them that happen to be out there. So Exchange will automatically look for addresses and email addresses and contacts and phone numbers and URLs. Put that information into the metadata with the item and use that to trigger whether or not your application happens to be active. Two other interesting ones is that Exchange 2013 will also look for a meeting suggestion or a task suggestion. If somebody sends you an email suggesting that you might want to go out for lunch, that actually can cause your application to be triggered. Quite powerful, because it's going to be able to apply a lot more logic to what's being done than you might be able to on your own. Now, so you can see a demo of what this happens to look like. Let me pump back into here for just a couple of seconds. So as we've said, in this particular application itself, I have a rule collection. I've got an item that has a known entity, and it's looking for a type of contact, or it has to have a known entity of a URL, or it has to have a regular expression that happens to match this particular expression value there. Okay, and once that happens, the application will be considered active. And so if I start my application from here, it's going to prompt me to log in. Now, this is one of the things, if you're going to be testing this out, again, you need to be running against an Exchange 2013 server. If you happen to have an Office 365 developer account, a developer subscription, then you have got an Exchange 2013 available for you, and that's exactly what I'm going to be using here. I promise I have to remember my password, don't I? That should do it. Okay, if you don't have it... So obviously I've got a bit of a problem with that. So let's try this again, make sure I've got that right. So just a second. Come on, you can do it. One more time for good luck. There we go. Problem is I have capitals in the wrong places. So anyway, this is going to open up an Outlook web application pointing at my account. It will have deployed my application into Exchange 2013, or at least the XML is what I'm trying to say. I've got a message, and you'll notice that it immediately pulled up Explore Mail app, which is my application, and Bing Maps. So in other words, both of these have been installed into my account. And there may be more apps, I don't know. The ones that don't activate don't appear on this particular list. When you want to see a particular application, you simply click on it. And so now what it's done is it's gone off, and in my particular case, there's some information here, and we'll talk a little bit about what the code looks like in a couple of seconds so you can see what the objects are and how they get manipulated. We'll take a look at what that is, but ultimately what it's done is it's recognized based on those rules that said, hey, this particular item, it is either a message or an appointment. It's a message. It has a contact, it has a URL, or it has a regular expression matching an invoice, and it has those as well. And you can see them highlight down here. So you can see that I've got, Bill Limerick, I've got Shelley Radigan, there's my invoice number, there's my URL that happens to be out there. Okay? Take a look at something like Bing Maps. Okay? Again, same basic idea. It recognized some addresses, and then it comes up with the functionality to actually be able to operate upon them, be able to work with them. In this case, it's going to put up maps. Now, don't get me wrong. Obviously, the UI that you see here, much more sophisticated than what Bing Maps happens to offer. But functionally, it's exactly the same thing. You haven't really changed anything along those lines. Okay? The application is using JavaScript, same as before, to grab information out of the mail item, and it turns out it's displaying it here. Okay? So let's take a look at the code that actually ran this. We don't need my XML anymore. But we have got in the page themselves, okay, more or less dirt simple, right? Again, my jQuery, my Ajax.js, my office.js, and my explore-mail-app.js happens to be where my code is going to be. Okay, the content itself, I've just got a couple of spans with names in them that I'm going to inject information in from the JavaScript itself. Now the JavaScript itself runs back here. And so basically it's doing the following. This will give you a sense of the kind of information that you happen to have available to you, right? First of all, in Office Initialize, I am grabbing my mailbox, so office.context.mailbox.userprofile. So this is the current user information that you happen to be looking for. And on the user profile, I have access to the current name. I've got access to the time zone that the user happens to be in. I can take a look at the item that's been sent in. I've got access to, again, office.context.mailbox.item. I can see the subject. I can see who it's being sent from. I have an array of people to whom it's being sent, and I can look at the name for any one of those. Okay, so there's some basic information that happens to be available about the mail item or the appointment that you happen to be working with. When it comes to the things that actually triggered me, I have a method called getEntities. And what getEntities does is it gets the known entities or the patterned entities that were found as part of the processing of my rule. So in this particular case, what getEntities does is I'm loading up the myEntities variable, and here's the list of URLs that it happened to find. And I am simply in here, just simply iterating across that JavaScript array of objects and passing them along. Okay, I am then when I'm finished, I find the URL span and I inject the string that I just built into that. Okay, I can go and call get filtered entities by name, and what this will do is this will get the entities that were given an ID in my manifest of state. In this case, my contacts were. And again, I grab them out of my item and I iterate across them, showing the person's name and the person's address. That's the information that's being pulled out of the metadata. And I dump it into my contact names span. Okay? My regular expression matches. I call get regex matches, which would match all the things that were invoices. Again, I enumerate across them. Okay, build up my string and put that list of invoices into the regex invoices span. So again, really simple, straightforward machinations to be able to grab information from the object itself, from the item itself, manipulate how I want to manipulate, and be able to push stuff in, there's things I can't update, naturally. I'm not going to be able to change the from or not be able to change the to, but I have the ability to add properties to the mail item in the same way that I was able to add properties to the document back when we were talking about the Office apps themselves, the Word apps. So the kinds of things that you would expect to be doing with this, these are just simply some suggestions. Let's say, for example, you can activate on a pattern. So in this particular case, I'm recognizing that what is being sent to me is a bug report, or it is a failure on a build. Information that is usually coming from something auto-generated, something that is I can recognize the patterns of and provide additional information. You'll see also package tracking, purchase orders, invoice numbers, things that I get normally, and I want to be able to have a one-click access into another part of functionality based on that information. You know, perhaps you're going to find entities based on item classes, URLs. So I can take a look at the URL, figure out what the, it's going to YouTube, or it's just any URL, and throw a thumbnail, a preview of that information out there. Recognize phone numbers and interact with the dialer in some way, shape, or form. Okay? Or I can do something that actually activates on every single item. So in this particular case, it's LinkedIn. It basically, for every item that comes up, it grabs information about the from and the to and displays that information inside of the web app. So I've got those three different kinds of options that happen to be available in terms of how I might be able to structure out my mail application. Okay? So basically that is it. as we've said, we've talked about the apps for Office to this particular point. You can see what they are. As I said, websites that happen to be integrated into the rich client or the web client versions of Office applications. We've taken a look at document-centric applications. We've taken a look at some mailbox-centric applications. Personally, I find these things, honestly, quite fun to use and quite much more flexible in terms of the capabilities that happen to exist out there. They are, they are much easier to deploy than any of the other applications, that any other kinds of custom applications you have yet. Now, I'll tell you, they're not meant for every possible scenario. There are some Office applications that I work with right now that or Office add-ins I work with right now that might not necessarily fit this model yet. This is still a fairly this is the apps model itself is fairly new, and so you're going to find that over the next while that Microsoft is going to extend and add to it. So I have no doubt that at some point almost every add-in that I'm currently using inside of Outlook, for instance, will eventually have a web version of it. Let's see. Oops, I wanted to come up into here. I'm not sure. Oh, look. We have some questions. Okay, so one of the questions is, yes, there we go. What if you have Office and Outlook 2010 and no Exchange Server? Okay, so there's a couple of things that, just so you know, with respect to that kind of a question. As JR mentioned, the apps model only works with Office 2013 and or Office 365. So for you to actually get the full experience of the apps themselves, you do have to be running Office 2013, or you have to be running on Office 365. Now, if you happen to add an app to a document inside of Office 2013, now this is for the content pane types inside of Excel. A task pane application, there really isn't anything that happens to work. But if you had added a content pane application into Excel, when you save that document and you send it to somebody else, there's basically two possibilities. First of all, when a person opens the document, if they're running Office 2013, actually, well, three possibilities. They open the document, they're running 2013, and they have the app already installed. It will work. So hold on. He thought we had done this. So let's do this. There we go. So hopefully you can see me now. Looks like you can. So basically that's the idea. So again, I create the application in 2013. I send it to somebody who already has that app installed. They will open the document and things will just simply work. If I send the application, the document to a, if I send the document to somebody who's got 2013 running but does not have the application installed, they will see a static image of what the app looked like when I saved it. In other words, whatever the image was that you saw at the time you saved the document, that image will be displayed. And if the user happens to click on it, then he will be able to, they will actually be prompted to install the application, download the XML. And if they do download it, then everything will work fine. If not, then they will see the static image and there's no interaction that happens to exist between, you know, the static image and the site. If you happen to send the document to 2010, then they will see the static image. It's not like the document's going to blow up. It's not like they're going to have any issues from that perspective. They will see that static image as it was when you saved the application before you sent it. So that's pretty much the interaction level at that particular level. Let's see. Any other questions that we might possibly have besides me being real? It's always a nice thing. Give you a couple of seconds to say more. Let's see. Like I said, I've been talking to people about this for quite a while. It's a very slick piece of functionality. It's still fairly, I'll even do it this way. The one thing that I didn't mention to you, and actually I can show you by flipping back to screen for a second. Right, when I do an install, an app for Office, and I see all, okay, I have the ability to drop down to an app store. Okay, and so if I go into an app store, this is where you can find additional apps for Office. And so this is for those of you that are developers in the world of what's the word I'm looking for, in the world of Windows Phone or Windows 8 applications, this shouldn't be of any news to you at all, right? That you basically have access to, look, we'll go look at my Facebook photos, because that's always going to be a fun thing. And if I click on that, you're going to see it load up in a second, hopefully. You'll see a page, again, assuming that this is, there goes my network connection, there it comes back again. You'll see a page that looks very similar to the application on the application page on Windows Phone Marketplace, Windows 8 Windows Store. Okay, and I can click on, and I've got details, I've got reviews, I've got the requirements that I happen to have. I can click on add, and when I click on add, that's going to download that XML file and load it to me. So through the store, I actually have access to a wide variety of different applications. And from you as a developer's perspective, you can write these applications as well. And you'll notice that there's actually apps for Office, apps for Outlook, apps for Excel, apps for SharePoint. And so you can write and you can publish these and push them up into the store. There's a process of validation similar to, probably actually less onerous than what you get inside of Windows Phone, Windows 8. But it's out there for you to use, and you can publish them, and people can use your applications. You'll notice that it's possible to, do we have any ones that are pay here? No, we didn't. I know we had some for Word, so I'm going to come back here. So you'll notice, for example, that there's actually cost for some of these things. Not every app happens to be a free app, although most of the ones you see here happen to be. But that's the basic premise behind this, is that you have that capability to even make money off of it. If there's any questions, you're more than welcome to post them to myself directly. If not, post them to JR. He'll arrange for them to be answered as well. And with that, I greatly appreciate your attention and forbearance to any problems. Thank you very much, and have yourself a fine and wonderful rest of the day.